We have stock details, we might have already mentioned in the 3CD, in the tax audit report, the stock records are not maintained. Even in that scenario, even in this case, actually stock records was not maintained. If you are able to develop, then at least as on 31st March, what was the closing stock? Whatever was the closing stock mentioned in the return of example, say for example 25 lakhs. If you are able to come out how this 25 lakhs figure has come out, and a list of that particular, detail of that particular closing stock, it may not come out of you, even though in 3CD we might have mentioned that quantitative details are not mentioned. When we say in the 3CD that quantitative details are not mentioned, what we are exactly mean to say that we do not have a day-to-day stock register. This was the opening stock, this much quantity received and this much issued and this much lying in the closing stock. But at the end of the year, we can have a quantitative statement, this particular goods is lying in stock, this is the value. So fortunately in this case, we had an argument that there was whatever is the closing stock, we prepared a quantitative details of that, and in some of those items of that alleged hawala purchases were part of this closing stock. So even this was one of the arguments influenced by on which the ITAT placed its ruling. These were our arguments, department argument on this, that supplier is not produced before the assessing officer. They are declared as hawala by the VAT department, and merely because check payment supplier transaction could not be taken as genuine. These are the only three standard arguments that the department is going to have. There could be a fourth argument, and if that much investigation is done, if that goes against him, then our case becomes very weak about the immediate cash withdrawal by that supplier. In this particular case, assessing officer did not do that finding, that what, when I issued a check, for example, on 10th of August, I issued a check and it is cleared in his bank account, then if immediately there is a corresponding cash withdrawal, then factually our case becomes very weak. Though I would say still there could be a different argument to how to controvert that. That's what I am saying, we have to see what are the factual circumstances of our case, and then only we have to consider whether how much this judgment is going to help us or not. So if there is an immediate cash withdrawal, if there is no immediate cash withdrawal, ITAT was influenced by that also. These arguments, in fact all these three arguments which the department is taking, technically speaking in my humble submission, at the appellate stage when you go to the tribunal or high court, these arguments will not be accepted. There are enough of judicial precedent which says these cannot go against the assessee. For a simple reason that a businessman is not supposed to be a CBI officer. If I am purchasing goods from somebody, I have made purchases, I received the goods, I made the payment, story is over. After 3 years, how can I compel him to come before the assessing officer? And there are enough judgments also of Supreme Court level that cross verification, if 133(6) is issued and that person doesn't turn up, it's not the assessee's duty, they can perhaps summon him. In many cases, some affidavits have been filed with the VAT department. If an affidavit is filed by the VAT, by those hawala dealers that we have not actually delivered the goods, they filed with the VAT department. The proper course of action is that we should have at least a copy of that affidavit. If the assessing officer doesn't give a copy of that affidavit, then our case becomes very strong. After giving that affidavit, we should get an opportunity of cross-examining. Because affidavit is just a simple statement that I have done something. Tomorrow I may give an affidavit that Taj Mahal belongs to me. You have to controvert with your factual finding. If you don't controvert, then I have given affidavit, Taj Mahal belongs to me. And that precisely is being done in case of these hawala dealers. Simply because they have raised their hands that we have given just a bogus billing, we have given an affidavit without giving an opportunity to cross-examine if the assessing officer is making an addition. At appellate stage, you will be having a very good case because it is his duty, they are relying on that affidavit. It is not our case that they have given some affidavit. It is the officer's version that there is an affidavit. If that person can come forward and give affidavit to the VAT department, he should come forward even with the income tax department. If I cannot ensure his presence, department has enough machinery to ensure his presence. If department has not a machinery to ensure his presence, how can they rely on an affidavit given by him? But these arguments, friends, very clear, you can place on record of the assessing officer, but he will not take practical experience, that he will not take any cognizance of all this thing. Perhaps they might also be bound by their said or unsaid guidelines by their superior authorities. They will be bound by that and they will be doing assessment in a routine manner. But if we bear these things in mind, at later stage we will be having a good case. Secondly, I will throw light on certain other judgment. ITAT finally gave the ruling in our favor because of these factual evidence which were fortunately very strong in our case. there was a proof of transportation of goods. Some part of goods were lying in the clothing shop. Payment was made through banking channels, and there was no proof of immediate cash withdrawal by the supplier. And because of this, ITAT gave us ruling in our favor. However, these factors needs to be evaluated cumulatively. Because for example, these were our submissions. These were department submission. These were the main factors which department has, ITAT has considered. Now in a particular case, some of these factors might be present, some of these factors might be absent. But in addition to that, there could be some other factual thing which might be in our favor. So an absence or a presence of one of these factors should not be either favorable or unfavorable. We have to cumulatively analyze what will be the cumulative impact. I have listed certain other factors also which were not applicable in our case but which could be applicable in other cases. So mere absence or presence of these factors should not lead to either a favorable or an adverse interpretation. We need to evaluate each case in the factual background. There are certain other rulings also on the same ground. In fact, in this judgment, we had relied on two judgments of Bombay High Court, perhaps I have listed in this. These two judgments of Bombay High Court, Babulal Borana versus 3rd ITU and another Nikunj Exim Enterprises, both are jurisdictional High Court decisions. These are actually not pertaining directly to Hawala transactions because these are old judgments. Second one is a recent judgment. The first one, 2005, is reported. The AY pertained to much prior, somewhere 97-98. But the decision pertained to purchases only. That time that Hawala controversy was not there. But the case was that 133-6 was served, creditor didn't turn up, and therefore that expenditure of that purchase was disallowed. Bombay High Court in both these cases has held that when payment is made by banking channel and there is some, in one particular case there was a quantitative reconciliation of the stock, even though quantitative detail is not mentioned either in 3CD, but at the assessment stage it's, at least if we can try to build out a quantitative reconciliation, this judgment will help us a lot. If a quantitative reconciliation is given and assessing officer is not able to find out any defect in that and the payment is by banking channel, Bombay High Court has accepted that you cannot doubt the purchases merely because that person is absconding right now. Businessman is not supposed to be a watchdog and to trace the people after the transaction is over. It is a government job to ensure their presence. Then there is an old judgment of Gujarat High Court in case of MK Brothers. There are also similar ruling where payments are made by checks and there is nothing to indicate that any part of the fund given by the assessee has come back to the assessee in any form. That means there is no finding that we have paid check and then we have received it in the form of cash. Then that expenditure cannot be disallowed. These two judgments of Jodhpur bench, these are, will be particularly very useful judgment. But again my humble request would be, don't apply any judgment blanketly. Study that entire order, try to analyze what are the facts in that particular case, try to jot down what are the facts in our case, to what extent we can rely on that. These two decisions of Jodhpur Tribunal are directly on Hawala purchases, Hawala under the Rajasthan VAT Act. Similar controversy has prevailed in Maharashtra. Rajasthan VAT Department listed certain people as defaulter on their website, additions were made. Jodhpur Tribunal is given a favorable ruling, no addition can be done when the payment is established through banking channel. Then there is another decision of Chandigarh Tribunal. It says statement made before Central Excise Authority is not relevant for income tax proceeding. Same is the case in our cases. They file certain affidavits or given some statement but not before the VAT authorities. Sorry, before the VAT authorities, not before the income tax authority. So income tax officer should separately obtain a statement for that. A statement made before some other authorities cannot be relevant for income tax assessment. That is the ruling by Chandigarh Tribunal. Then another judgment of Delhi Tribunal. Again, it is on the similar line. Non-filing of confirmation from suppliers, it cannot be held that assessee has not received the goods from these persons. Then Jaipur Tribunal, non-production of parties is not again sufficient to draw any adverse inference, particularly where the addresses given by the assessee tallied with those available with the bankers of those parties and with the censured authorities. So KYC, that thing which I was mentioning earlier. Lastly, there is a third member judgment of Amritsar Tribunal in case of purchase which are not adequately documented. If the gross profit declared is in line with the past gross profit rates, no addition should be made. There could be certain other factors based on peculiar facts. For example, in case of a trading business, if you are not able to get documentary evidence of transportation of goods received, at least if you are able to get a documentary evidence of goods sold by us, there are enough judgments on that. In fact, I forgot to include in this particular slide, but there are many judgments to this count that if sale is proved, And there is also a documentary evidence, and it's like Sone Pe Suhaga. If I have sold something, then I should have purchased something. It cannot be a case of purchasing something out of vacuum and selling it. So if we have details not on transportation of purchases, but at least transportation of sales, that could help us. Secondly, if we are able to match the quantities or the match the purchase bill qua particular sales bill. If I purchase from Mr. XYZ, who is alleged to be our dealer, I purchase item A, item B, item C. It might be difficult to trace in which particular sales bill these items have been sold, particularly where the transactions are voluminous. But at least to some extent, 50%, 25%, 75% extent, whatever extent we can correlate that these are the particular sales bill in which these particular items have been sold, then this will be a good case to argue, if not at assessment, then at least at appeal stage. Another scenario or could be in case of manufacturing things, particularly people think that the details of consumption etc. might be difficult. I would suggest in case of a manufacturing environment, if we can get some technical details, that if this particular machine is maintained, this requires a certificate from an engineer or from some qualified person, that this machine requires this particular material. And one of these materials is involved in this alleged hawala dealer. Then technically, it will be very difficult for the assessing officer to counterpart the technical finding. He is not an expert in technical. If an engineer gives you a certificate that this machinery requires this particular item and this I have purchased. So if I have manufactured this machinery, it is impossible to manufacture this machinery with this part. And I have manufactured the machinery, I have sold that machinery. That means I have used that particular part. If I use that particular part, that means I have purchased it. So it's not a direct evidence, but it's a circumstantial evidence of all the facts which will help us. Similarly, in assessment stage, please try to at least place on record your objections. Objections as to what? If I may denote 5 or 10 minutes for the reassessment, the channel of reassessment is when the 148 comes, they ask us to file a return of income. Generally, file a standard reply that we already filed a return of income that may be taken in response to 148, etc. Seek a copy of the reasons. Then, after the reasons, what they do is they send you a lamba choda questionnaire in which there is one point relating to hawala and there are certain other details required also. So there is another controversy in that 148. If 148 is done, whether that 148 should be restricted only qua hawala dealings for which the 148 has been issued, or you can make addition in respect to other additions also. Department is of the opinion that once 148 is done, they have a blanket sword in their hand and they will do anything. However, there are judicial precedent, there is judgment of Punjab and Haryana High Court, and there are many tribunal judgment which says that 148 is open only qua under assessment items. If in the course of that under assess something comes to the knowledge of the assessing officer, he can add it. But he cannot make an inquiry with respect to other things. If I may give a very apt example, in case of hawala purchases, he might ask for the bank statement. In fact, we will only be producing the bank statement. Now in that bank statement, if you find there is a huge cash deposit, then he might probably ask about that cash deposit, he might make an addition for that. But in the course of hawala purchases, if he is harassing you for some other transaction, you sold this property, capital gain issue, that which has nothing to do with hawala, at least place your objection at the time of assessment. I am quite confident he will not listen to you. But place that adjustment on record that you objected to them at that stage. All these cumulative things will help you at later stage if there are numerous other additions other than hawala. There are quite a few prevalent judgments also which say their addition should be restricted to at least at the basis of GP, etc. Though it might be favorable, in my humble understanding, I don't understand how a GP addition can be based in this case. Either the purchases are genuine or they are not genuine. If they are not genuine, they should be disallowed 100%. If they are genuine, the GP I have already offered for taxation. Where comes the state? But at least to buy peace, sometimes assessi also say if they add 15%, 20% GP add kar dete and we get peace of mind, it is fine enough. But technically speaking, either there should be 100% addition or there should be no addition. We should try to build up our case in such a way that we do not have any addition. If you build your case properly at assessment stage, at appellate stage, at least you will get a relief partially, maybe to some extent. This was my brief thing about this hawala purchase as well as PCD. If you have any questions, I am here to answer. Thanks a lot for the patient hearing.
So members who want to enroll their staff or new members for the coaching class may kindly do so. The details would be available on the website shortly. The intensive study circle would start from the first week of November, which is on every alternate Saturday morning, so that would also start. the joint workshop with the various other organizations like BCA, CTC, that would commence in the first week of December. We are having series of programs over the next 4-5 months. So members may kindly take the advantage of that. The most coveted event of our association, the Residential Refresher Course, the RRC, has been scheduled this year at New Delhi. The dates are 13th February to 17th of February. The check-in over there is from 14th of February. So 14th Feb to 17th Feb are the dates at Delhi. So those who want to book their tickets for air or anything, and those who want to join directly can kindly plan their schedule accordingly. The details will be available on the website. The hotel is Hotel Kempinski, Leela Kempinski. And also, in the next month, we will be having our picnic from 4th October to 6th of October at Lord's Resort, Silvassa. The details have already been circulated to the members and are available on the website. I am not going into the details of them, but kindly note all these dates and give your active participation to the various activities of the association. Coming to the present task of vote of thanks, today being a Teacher's Day, let me share one more thing. Devendra Jain is also a tutor at Mahesh Tutorials. He teaches CA final students, and today, very aptly, he has taught all of us the basics of CCD and the Hawala Purchase requirements. Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwara, Guru Shakshat Parabrahma, Tasmai Shri Guru Venama. I think this is the apt slogan for today, the apt anecdote for today. And the way he has meticulously analyzed each and every clause of Form 3CD, the existing clause, the amended clause, the precautions to be taken, and also regarding the Hawala purchases, based on the facts of his case, very honestly he has told that he is no magician. Very honestly he has told that it has all depended on the facts of the case and the person who was appearing at the lower level, at the assessment level, in the CIT appeal level. He had made all the groundwork ready. And we are the people who are generally appearing at these levels. And we need to take the lessons from what he has taught today. It was a marvelous exposition on the subject, Devendra. And I request all of you to please carry out a very loud applause. Next slide for the national anthem.